Welcome to the University of Nottingham. I've got with me Dr. Marian Kelsey, and Marian is an expert in the Hebrew Bible and teaches the interpretation of the Hebrew Bible here. So Marian, you're welcome. You are interested in the patriarch Jacob. Can you tell us, well, first of all, tell us who the patriarch Jacob is, remind us who the patriarch Jacob is, and then tell us why it's significant that we should study him.
Jacob was one of the ancestors of the people of Israel. And the kind of Israelite genealogy, you might say, started with Abraham. And then Abraham's son was Isaac, and then Isaac's son was Jacob. And so Jacob is the grandson of Abraham in the biblical narrative, but he is also seen as the father of the nation Israel, because Jacob had 12 sons, and those 12 sons became the 12 tribes of Israel. And he's important to study for that reason, because he is the father of the 12 tribes of Israel. He's also an extremely interesting figure in the Bible. Abraham is very righteous, very upright, a very worthy man, and for that reason, a little bit boring. Isaac, we don't get much about him at all, two or three chapters, but then Jacob, we get a lot of stuff about him. And he's a really interesting man who doesn't always get up to quite the right sort of thing. And that makes his story much more engaging to read. And we actually start with him still in his mother's womb. And he's one of a pair of twins. And we have him wrestling with his brother Esau in his mother's womb, kind of struggling to be the first one out, because then he would be the firstborn. And that matters a lot. But he didn't manage it. Esau was the first one out. And that would have meant that Esau got much more inheritance, and he was the firstborn, and the expectation would be that a lot of the privileges that the father had would accrue to Esau and go down his line. But what we get in Jacob's youth is him tricking and bargaining the blessing of the patriarchs and the inheritance, the biggest inheritance from his father, tricking them out of Esau. And Esau is obviously not very happy about that. And so Jacob has to flee the country because he's afraid that his brother will kill him. And he flees to his cousins and has all sorts of adventures. And one of those adventures is when he falls in love, and he falls in love with Rachel, a daughter of a relation of his, and he wants to marry her. But Jacob, he is himself a trickster, but his cousin Laban, the father of Rachel, kind of rivals him in tricksterness. And Laban knows that Jacob is in love with Rachel, and that Jacob will give him an awful lot to be able to marry Rachel. And so he gets 7 years of work out of Jacob for Rachel's hand in marriage. And then on the wedding night, he swaps Rachel around with her sister, Leah, and Jacob ends up marrying Leah instead of Rachel. And Jacob, the trickster, has been tricked in this swapping off of the sister for the woman that he loves. And so he has to work another 7 years before he can finally marry Rachel as well. And so he's kind of got his comeuppance in a way. And then later on, his two wives have lots of children. Those are the 12 sons who end up the 12 patriarchs, the 12 tribes of Israel. And eventually he decides to go back to his homeland, go back to his parents' land with all his wives and all his children. And on the way back, just as he gets to the border of the promised land, the land of his fathers, a mysterious figure pops up in the middle of the night, and without any warning or explanation, he wrestles with Jacob. And he and Jacob have this wrestling match through the night, and just as we're getting to the morning, the mysterious figure says to Jacob, "Let me go, for dawn is breaking." And Jacob says, "No, I won't let you go until you bless me." And so the mysterious figure blesses Jacob and calls him Israel, which is where the name Israel comes from in the biblical presentation. And then Jacob lets him go and he disappears. And Jacob decides that this mysterious figure is God, and that he's seen God and wrestled with God in that nighttime encounter. And one of the very interesting things about this particular narrative, this particular passage, is that it's not altogether clear whether you're supposed to believe Jacob that that was God he was wrestling with, because the narrator of the story doesn't seem to think that it is God. The narrator seems to think that this was a man or possibly an angel, but not God. And so Jacob is again kind of pushing his luck a little bit, and he's deciding on the most advantageous interpretation of the situation for him, because obviously it's much more significant to get a new name out of God than an angel. And so he goes off back into the promised land with his new name and with the blessing of this mysterious figure that he has decided is God, and goes on to be the father of the nation Israel.
Marian, thank you so much for this lovely introduction to this crucial part of the memory of the Hebrew Bible. Thank you.